you, Coraline. We're going to continue on the book on chapters 4 and 5. Let's see what we got here. Chapter 4. See the little doggy? Chapter 4. The house looked exactly the same from the outside. Exactly the same. Around Miss Pink and Miss Forcible's door were blue and red light bulbs that flashed on and off, spelling out the words. The lights chasing each other around the door, on and off, around and around. Astounding was followed by a theatrical and then triumph. It was a sunny, cold exactly like the one she'd left. There was a polite noise coming from behind her. She turned around. Standing on the wall next to her was a large black cat, identical to the large black cat she'd seen in the grounds at home. "Good afternoon," said the cat. Its voice sounded like the voice at the back of Coraline's head. The voice, she thought. Words in, but a man's voice.
See that.
shut behind her, and the room was black. Coraline edged forward into a small anteroom. Her face brushed against something soft. It was cloth. She reached up her hand and pushed at the cloth. It parted. She stood blinking on the other side of the velvet curtains in a poorly lit theater. Far away at the edge of the room was a high wooden stage, empty and bare, in a dim spotlight, shining onto it from high above. There were seats between Coraline and the stage, rows and rows of seats. She heard shuffling noise, and a light came toward her, swinging from side to side. When it was closer, she saw the light was coming from a flashlight being carried in the mouth of a large black Scotty dog, its muzzle gray with age. "Hello," said Coraline. The dog put the flashlight down on the floor and looked up at her. "Right. Let's see your ticket," he said gruffly. "Ticket. That's what I said. Ticket. I haven't got all day, you know. You can't watch the show without a ticket." Coraline sighed. "I don't have a ticket," she admitted. "Another one," said the dog gloomily. "Come in here." "Paulus, anything." "Where's your ticket? Haven't got one. I don't know." It shook its head, then shrugged. "Come on then." He picked up the flashlight in his mouth and trotted off into the dark. Coraline followed him. When he got near the front of the stage, he stopped and shone the flashlight onto an empty seat. Coraline sat down and the dog wandered off. As her eyes got used to the darkness, she realized that the other inhabitants of the seats were also dogs. There was a sudden hissing from behind the stage. Coraline decided it was the sound of a scratchy old record being put onto a record player. The hissing became the noise of trumpets, and Miss Pink and Miss Forcible came onto the stage. Miss Pink was riding a one-wheeled bicycle and juggling balls. Miss Forcible skipped behind her, holding a basket of flowers. She scattered the flower petals across the stage as she went. They reached the front of the stage, and Miss Pink leaped nimbly off the unicycle, and the two old women bowed low. All the dogs thumped their tails and barked enthusiastically. Coraline clapped politely. Then they unbuttoned their fluffy round coats and opened them. But their coats weren't all that open. Their faces open too, like empty shells, and out of the old empty fluffy round bodies stepped two young women. They were thin and pale and quite pretty and had black button eyes. The new Miss Pink was wearing green tights and high brown boots that went most of the way up her legs. The new Miss Forcible dress and had flowers in her long yellow hair. Coraline pressed back against her seat. Miss Pink went off the stage and the noise of trumpets squealed as the gramophone needle dug its way across the record and was pulled off. "This is my favorite bit," whispered the little dog in the seat next to her. The other Miss Forcible picked a knife out of a box on the corner of the stage. "Is this a dagger that I see before me?" she asked. "Yes," shouted all the little dogs. "It is." Miss Forcible curtsied, and all the dogs applauded again. Coraline didn't bother clapping this time. Miss Mink came back on. She slapped her thigh, and all the little dogs woofed. "And now," Miss Pink said, "Miriam and I proudly present I have a big round of applause for the young volunteer, as Miss Mink. The dogs woofed and squealed and thumped their tails on the velvet seats. Now, Coraline, said Miss Mink, what's your name? Coraline, said Coraline, and we don't know each other. You like like it, said Coraline's mother. Because we like to think that this is your home. You can stay here forever and always, if you want to, said Coraline. She put her hand in her pockets and thought about it. Her hand touched the stone that the real Mrs. Pink and Forcible had given her the day before. The stone. Strange voices whispered and distant winds howled. She glass of water. She waited for her parents to come back. When it began to get dark, Coraline microwaved herself a frozen pizza. Then Coraline watched television. She wondered why grown-ups gave themselves all the good programs, with all the shouting and running around in. After a while, she started yawning. Then she undressed, brushed her teeth, and put herself to bed. In the morning, she went into her parents' room, but their bed hadn't been slept in, and they weren't around. She ate canned spaghetti for breakfast. For lunch, she had a block of cooking chocolate and an apple. The apple was yellow and slightly shriveled, but it tasted sweet and good. For tea, she went down to see Mrs. Pink and Forcible. She had three digestive biscuits, a glass of limeade, and a cup of weak tea. The limeade was very interesting. It didn't taste anything like limes. It tasted bright green and vaguely chemical. Coraline liked it enormously. She wished they had it at home. "How are your dear mother and father?" asked Miss Pink. "Missing," said Coraline. "I haven't seen either of them since yesterday. I'm on my own. I think I've probably become a single child family. Tell your mother that we found the Glasgow Empire Press clippings we were telling her about. She seemed very interested when Miriam mentioned them to her." "She's vanished under mysterious circumstances," said Coraline, "and I believe my father has as well. I'm afraid we'll be out all day tomorrow, Coraline. Lovely," said Miss Forcible. "We'll be staying over with April's niece in Royal Tunbridge Wells." They showed Coraline a photographic album, a photograph of Miss Pink's niece in it, and then Coraline went home. She opened her money box and walked down to the supermarket. She brought two large bottles of limeade, a chocolate cake, and a new bag of apples, and went back home and ate them for dinner. She cleaned her teeth and went into her father's office. She woke up his computer and wrote a story. Coraline's story. There was a girl. Her name was Apple. She used to dance a lot. She danced and danced until her feet turned into sausages. The end. She printed out the story and turned off the computer. Then she drew a picture of the little girl dancing underneath the words of the paper. She ran herself a bath with too much bubble bath in it, and the bubbles ran over the side and went all over the floor. She dried herself and the floor as best as she could, and went to bed. Coraline woke up in the night. She went into her parents' bedroom, but the bed was made and empty. The glowing green numbers on the digital clock glowed 3:12 a.m. All alone, in the middle of the night. Coraline began to cry. There was no other sound in the empty flat. She climbed into her parents' bed, and after a while, she went to sleep. Coraline was woken by cold paws patting her face. She opened her eyes. Big green eyes stared back at her. It was the cat. "Hello," said Coraline. "How did you get in?" The cat didn't say anything. Coraline got out of bed. She was wearing a long t-shirt and pajama bottoms. "Have you come to tell me something?" The cat yawned, which made its eyes flash green. "Do you know where Mommy and Daddy are?" The cat blinked at her slowly. "Is that a yes?" The cat blinked again. Coraline decided that that was indeed a yes. "Will you take me to them?" father opened his mouth and said something, but she could hear nothing at all. Her mother breathed on the inside of the mirror glass, and quickly before the fog faded, she wrote, "Help us," with the tip of her forefinger. The fog on the inside of the mirror faded, and so did her parents. And now the mirror reflected only the corridor, and Coraline, and the cat. "Where are they?" Coraline asked the cat. The cat made no reply, but Coraline could imagine its voice, dry as a dead fly on a windowsill in winter, saying, "Well, where do you think they are?" "They aren't going to come back, are they?" said Coraline. "Not under their own stream." The cat blinked at her. Coraline took it as a yes. "Right," said Coraline. "Then I suppose there is only one thing left to do." She walked into her father's study. She sat down at his desk. Then she picked up the telephone, and she opened the phone book and telephoned the local police station. "Police," said a gruff male voice. "Hello," she said. "My name is Coraline Jones." "You're up a bit after your bedtime, aren't you, young lady?" said the policeman. "Possibly," said Coraline, who was not going to be diverted. "But I am ringing to report a crime." "And what sort of crime would that be?" "Kidnapping. Grown-up napping, really. My parents have been stolen away into a world on the other side of the mirror in our wall." "And do you know who stole them?" asked the police officer. Coraline could hear the smile in his voice, and she tried extra hard to sound like an adult might sound, to make him take her seriously. "I think my other mother has them both in her clutches. She may want to keep them and sew their eyes with black buttons, or she may simply have them in order to lure me back into reach of her fingers. I'm not sure." "Ah, the nefarious clutches of her fiendish fingers, is it?" he said. "You know what I suggest, Miss Jones?" "No," said Coraline.
"What?"
"You ask your mother to make you a big old mug of hot chocolate, and then give you a great big old hug. There's nothing like hot chocolate and a hug for making the nightmares go away. And if she starts to tell you off for waking you up at this time of night, why, you tell her that that's what the policeman said." He had a deep, reassuring voice. Coraline was not reassured. "When I see her," said Coraline, "I shall tell her that." And she put down the telephone. The black cat, who had sat on the floor grooming his fur through the entire conversation, now stood up and led the way into the hall. Coraline went back into her bedroom and put on her blue dressing gown and her slippers. She looked under the sink for a flashlight and found one. But the batteries had long since run down, and it barely glowed with the faintest straw-colored light. She put it down again and found the box of in-case-of-emergency white wax candles. And thrust one into his candlestick. She put an apple into each pocket. She picked up the ring of keys and took the old black key off the ring. She walked back into the drawing room and looked at the door. She had the feeling that the door was looking at her, which she knew was silly and knew on a deeper level was somehow true. She went back into her bedroom and rummaged in the pocket of her jeans. She found the stone with the hole in it and put it in her dressing gown pocket. She lit the candle wick with a match and watched it sputter and light. Then she picked up the black key. It was cold in her hand. She put it into the keyhole in the door, best place to go for a walk, really. There were all these things that people had thrown away back there. Old cookers and broken dishes and dolls with no arms and no legs and empty cans and broken bottles. Mom and Dad made me promise not to go exploring back there because there were too many sharp things and tetanus and such. But I kept telling them I wanted to explore it. So one day, my dad put on his big brown boots and his gloves and put my boots on me and my jeans and sweater, and we went for a walk. We must have walked for about 20 minutes. We went down this hill to the bottom of a gully where a stream was, when my dad had suddenly said to me, "Coraline, run away, up the hill, now." He said it in a sight. Side of her. She could not tell. It seemed as if in having a traveling companion of such wisdom and intelligence. Its tone remained sarcastic, but its fur was bristling and its brush of a tail stuck up in the air. Coraline was going to say something like, "Sorry," or, "Wasn't it a lot shorter walk last time?" when the candle went out as suddenly as if it had been stuffed by someone's hand. There was a scrabbling and a pattering, and Coraline could feel her heart pounding against her ribs. She put out one hand and felt something wispy, like a spider's web, brush her hands and her face. At the end of the corridor, the electric light went on, blinding after the darkness. A woman stood, silhouetted by the light, a little ahead of Coraline. "Coraline, darling," she called. "Mom," said Coraline, and she ran forward, eager and relieved. "Darling," said the woman, "why did you ever run away from me?" Coraline was too close to stop, and she felt the other mother's cold arms enfold her. She stood there, ragged and trembling, as the other mother held her tightly. "Where are my parents?" Coraline asked. "We're here," said her other mother, in a voice so close to her real mother's that Coraline could scarcely tell them apart. "We're here. We're ready to love you, and play with you, and feed you, and make your life interesting." Coraline pulled back, and the other mother let her go, with reluctance. The other father, who had been sitting on a chair in the hallway, stood up and smiled. "Come on into the kitchen," he said. "I'll make us a midnight snack, and you'll want something to drink. Hot chocolate, perhaps." Coraline walked down the hallway until she reached the mirror at the end. There was nothing reflected in it but a young girl in her dressing gown and slippers who looked like she had recently been crying, but whose eyes were real eyes, not black buttons, and who was holding tightly to a burned-out candle in a candlestick. She looked at the girl in the mirror, and the girl in the mirror looked back at her. "I will be brave," thought Coraline. "No, I am brave." She put down the candlestick on the floor, then turned around. The other mother and the other father were looking at her hungrily. "I don't need a snack," she said. "I have an apple, see?" And she took an apple from her dressing gown pocket and dipped it into it with relish and an enthusiasm that she did not really feel. The other father looked disappointed. The other mother smiled, showing a full set of teeth, and each of the teeth was a tiny bit too long. The lights in the hallway made her black button eyes glitter and gleam. "You don't frighten me," said Coraline, although they did frighten her very much. "I want my parents back." Daytime already. Coraline was looking at the hallway, all the nice it is not to have Coraline anymore, said her mother with a happy smile. Now we can do all the things we want, always wanted to do, like go abroad, but we're prevented from doing by having a little daughter. And, said her father, I take great comfort in knowing that her other mother will take better care of her than we ever could. The mirror fogged and faded and reflected the night once more. See, said her other mother. No, said Coraline, I don't see, and I don't believe it either. She hoped that what she had just seen was not real, but she was not as certain as she sounded. There was a tiny doubt inside her, like a maggot in an apple core. Then she looked up and saw the expression on her mother's face, a flash of real anger, which crossed her face like summer lightning. And Coraline was sure in her heart that what she had seen in the mirror was no more than an illusion. Coraline sat down on the sofa and ate her apple. Please, said her other mother, don't be difficult. She walked into the drawing room and clasped her hands twice. There was a rustling noise, and a black rat appeared. It stared up at her. Bring me the key, she said. The rat chittered. Then it ran through the open door that led back to Coraline's old flat. The rat returned, dragging the key behind it. Why don't you have your own key on this side? Asked Coraline. There is only one key, only one door, said the other father. Hush, said the other mother. You must not bother our darling Coraline's head with such trivialities. She put the key in the keyhole and twisted. The lock was stiff, but it clunked close. She dropped the key into her apron pocket. Outside, the sky had begun to lighten to a luminous gray. If we aren't going to have a midnight snack, said the other mother, we still need our beauty sleep. I am going back to bed, Coraline. I would strongly suggest that you do the same. She placed her long white fingers on the shoulders of the other father, and she walked him out of the room. Coraline walked over to the door at the far side of the drawing room. She tapped on it, but it was tightly locked. The door of her other parents' bedroom was now closed. She was indeed tired, but she did not want to sleep in the bedroom. She did not want to sleep under the same roof as her other mother. The front door was not locked. Coraline walked out into the drawing and down the stone stairs. She sat down on the bottom step. It was cold. Something furry pushed itself against her side in one smooth, insinuating motion. Coraline jumped, then breathed a sigh of relief when she saw what it was. Oh, it's you, she said to the black cat. See, said the cat, it wasn't so hard recognizing me, was it? Even without names. Well, what if I wanted to call you? The cat wrinkled its nose and managed to look unimpressed. Calling cats, it confided, tends to be a rather overrated activity. Might as well call a whirlwind. What if it was dinner time? Asked Coraline. Wouldn't you want to be called then? Of course, said the cat. But a simple cry of dinner would do nicely. See, no need for names. Why does she want me? Coraline asked the cat. Why does she want me to stay here with her? She wants something to love, I think, said the cat. Something that isn't her. She might want something to eat as well. challenges. What kind of thing is that? Asked Coraline. But the cat made no answer, simply stretched luxuriantly. And walked away. Then it stopped and turned and said, I'd go inside if I were you. Get some sleep. You have a long day ahead of you. And then the cat was gone. Still, Coraline realized it had a point. She crept back into the silent house, past a closed bedroom door, inside which the other mother and the other father, what, she wondered, slept. Waited. And then it came to her that, should she open the bedroom door, she would find it empty. And more precisely, that it was an empty room. And it would remain empty until the exact moment that she opened the door. Somehow, that made it easier.